as we're taking a quick break to have our floor swept, I just wanted to make mention that there are QR codes scattered around the perimeter of the space. There's one out here that has program notes. So if you're interested in learning more about the work that we've made this evening, or more about the artists that you're seeing on stage this morning, this evening, scan that QR code. And I'm gonna pass this off to Masha, an incredible executive director of Hudson River Museum.
Thank you, everyone. And this pause is absolutely worth the wait. I was very lucky because I got to see the dress rehearsal. And for those of you who weren't aware, since March, right? March of 24, MorDance has been the teaching artist in residence here at the Hudson River Museum. And I'm actually recognizing a lot of faces who have come to see their performances and be part of the workshops. They've engaged with our junior docents. They have done incredible workshops in and through the galleries, including almost like a flash mob dance performance, which was incredible. I know that we mentioned Art Bridges earlier tonight, but I want to emphasize how important that relationship has been. The Art Bridges Foundation and the Hudson River Museum have been working together for several years to bring top quality arts experiences to the people in our community. And tonight is just a wonderful example of that. Whether it's theater or dance or painting or music, Art Bridges supports a lot. And so I want to recommend to you all, if you have not yet indulged in our free First Fridays, the first Friday of every month, the museum is open for free from 5 to 8, and it's always programmed with exceptional entertainment. And so I just want to encourage you, stop by and just know that you can kick off your weekend here with the museum. I will also just kind of on the side note say, yes, there is a bar, so if you'd like a little nice libation, that is there as well. But there's also always a sketching opportunity, some kind of artistic expression. So just a reminder, you can kick your weekend off with us, and we're really thrilled. So the first Friday of every month from now until at least the next 3 years, which is incredible support by Art Bridges, we'll be doing that. So I hope you make that a wonderful habit and kick off your weekend in a wonderful social and creative way. I think that are we ready to go? Okay, so let's go back to this fantastic performance, and again, let's hear it for more dance.
Thank you.
I'm back one more time to build a little moment as Tevin and Joe change for our next work. And our next work has been a culmination of a month-long creative process for our new work that is inspired by the exhibit here at the museum, Rivers Flow Artists Connect. The work is entitled Riverbound and has been generously sponsored by Karen and Edwin Sue, who have made this work possible. Our contributors to our art form make what we do here happen. If it wasn't for Karen and Ed, we'd be at a loss for making this work. So we are internally grateful for them and their support. If you can join me in giving them a round of applause. This evening, we'll talk a little bit more after the performance. Some of the artists that have been involved in the whole program will join me on stage to answer all of your burning questions. So we hope you stick around and ask us whatever you'd like about any of the pieces for any of our artists. Paulina will be with us. This piece that you just saw is actually a work in progress. It's a piece that's inspired by Susan Simard's research on trees and how they communicate via mycorrhizal connections. It will be our big premiere next spring at our space in Yonkers. Those of you that don't know MorDance, we moved to Yonkers in January and have hit the ground running since we've moved here, thanks to so many of our incredible community partners like Hudson River Museum, who are a partner in the arts, a partner in our community outreach programs. We're so lucky for their support. We're grateful to be here today, and we're grateful to be the teaching artists in residence here at Hudson River Museum, and look forward to a very, very long partnership with Hudson River Museum. When I founded the company 10 years ago, it was a goal of mine to make the art that we make accessible to everyone, from the narratives that we're telling on stage to low-cost ticket initiatives to free performances to after-school programs with under-resourced youth. And Hudson River Museum really shares in that mission and that vision for the arts, and we're very grateful to have a partner like them. I'm still killing time. No, am I good, Heather? I can wrap it up? Yes? No, keep talking. Okay. One other thing that I would love to talk to you all about is we've been recommended for congressionally directed spending by Senator Gillibrand, and this funding is to buy and build out the space that we currently occupy in downtown Yonkers. It would be a dream for us to own our own facility, and the way you can help, because we haven't received this funding yet, the way you can help is go to our website. We have a petition going. Again, if you scan these QR codes, there's links upon links that take you. But we have a petition going to try to secure this funding. It's a long process. Yes, Senator Gillibrand has recommended us, but it has to go through Senate appropriations and House appropriations. No New York senators sit on Senate appropriations, so it's a long process. So if you can sign our petition, if you can share it with all your friends, we want to build a performing arts center in downtown Yonkers and have a forever home in this city. So please sign our petition, write a letter of support about why this is needed in Yonkers and why this is needed now. Heather is telling me I'm good to stop talking. Enjoy the rest of the program.
Sometimes I'm gonna fall in jail. Sometimes I'm gonna honey come back. Sometimes I'm gonna rap that jail. Sometimes so high. Oh, Lord, I travel so high. Don't nobody know my trouble, God. Don't nobody know my trouble, God. Went down the hill of the day. So God happy and stayed all day. shuffle of angels' feet. He put one hand upon my head, grabbed up the mighty lemon tail, what he said. Go tell that lonesome liar, go tell that midnight rider, tell the gambling, raveling, backslider, tell the gold mighty, gonna cut him down. He might run on for a long time. Run on, darken and dodge it, run on, June, for a long time. Let me tell you, God Almighty, gonna cut you down. You might run on for a long time.
She's an incredible filmmaker. And Helena, do you want to come down as well? I asked them to grab us a couple extra chairs, so. Am I forgetting anyone that should be up here? No, I think this is it. So our dancers will head out in a moment, but if you have any questions, especially for Helena, our composer of Trees, or for Sydney as an artist that helped inspire this final piece of the program, we'd love to answer any of your questions, or for me as the choreographer and the person who doesn't sleep to make all of these things happen. Does anyone have any questions?
Is the water cold?
That's a great question. The water. We actually have a hot and cold faucet here at our studio space. We only have cold water. And no air conditioning, though. So the cold water was actually very refreshing during the rehearsal process. And this week, we were rehearsing a bit outside, so as you can imagine, the water that sat upstage for a while ended up being quite warm, but it was refreshing, surprisingly. Yeah. Does anyone else have any questions? Yes.
Are you worried about their limbs? It's so slippery.
Oh, I'm terrified. I have the worst anxiety watching this piece. In all fairness, I did all of this as well, and there's This is a great question for the dancers when they come out. There's a lot of communication back and forth between me as the choreographer. You know, I'll come to them and say, I'm really looking to get this visually. How can we do that? And you know, if it's a lift or something, there's a conversation, does this feel safe? And my sort of habit as a choreographer is to make things fast. They will tell you it's always more and more steps and less counts. But when you're dealing with the water, there was always that aspect of ideally what I wanted, but really what was physically possible and safe. So it was a process, to say the least. But I'm always, anytime they're performing, I'm always nervous. I'm a mom, so I feel like I've got that mom angst watching them dance. What about some questions up here? Can you shout them at me? One of you young ladies. So that's a great question. So the work is inspired by rivers and large bodies of water, really, in general. It enabled the dancers to move in a different way. That was challenging as a choreographer, but it opened new possibilities to new movement, and I'm hoping that it gave the sort of aesthetic and feel of the flow, like our beautiful Hudson River that we live on, and kind of created more of that slip and slide that you can't get if the floor isn't slippery. Yeah, any other questions? Yes, right here. So the second piece, there's three different colors. There's black, which represents ash. Oh, the question, yes, thank you. She asked, why did we use the colors for the second piece? The three different colors, the black represented ash. The sort of rusty color that Ayaka had obviously represented rust. And then the final color that Lauren had, the red, is representative of blood. And to me, that work was kind of really inspired by the deteriorating of our human rights. I think it's something that we're always fighting for. We're always fighting for rights as a society. And to me, those things, the ash, the blood, and the rust really represented that. I go into it in very great depth in our program notes, but this was a new piece that was just created, and when we finished it a couple weeks ago, it needs more. It's a piece that will be expanded into something larger, but that's kind of where that came from for me. And again, it needs to be a larger and longer piece. It's a larger and longer conversation than just 4 minutes. So that piece will be expanded as well. Other questions? Now that we have a couple dancers here as well, Claire and Tevin and David. Does anyone have any questions for the dancers or Polina as our composer? Oh, down here. There's a mic coming to you. There we go. Thanks, Heather.
Was there any reason why you chose green in the first thing? Why'd you choose green?
Green. So that short duet is part of a 50-minute ballet called Fats Waller's Rhythm, and it's all to music that Fats Waller either composed himself or made famous by singing. And playing the piano, and the arc of the ballet is inspired by Fats Waller in his life. He was an incredible Harlem jazz musician during the Harlem Renaissance, and the piece is inspired by him. So there's actually four couples in the ballet, and they all have different colors on. The couple that you saw tonight wore the green, and it actually, Lauren wore the green because it's a different cast than when we did it in 2018, and that costume looked perfect on her. So that's why she had the green, but there is a green dress, a yellow dress, an orange dress, and I'm blanking, a blue dress. So yeah, there's a lot that goes into picking the palette colors and everything for a costume, just like there are, I'm sure, as visual artists when they're editing films and making their art as well. Other questions? Anything for the dancers? Yes. Hey.
We were talking before you came out about the dancing on the giant slip and slide. And I'd love to hear your thoughts. I was terrified for you, but was it scary or fun?
Definitely the first day, but also maybe the first like three or four rehearsals were really scary. I actually came to Morgan separately and I was like, I don't know that I can do this piece. I was really, really nervous. And it's funny how you just get more and more used to it. And also because it starts with the less amount of water we add more and more, it's literally almost like going into the shallow end of the pool and then slowly immersing yourself into water or, dipping your toes in if it's cold and then getting acclimated. Even just now when I came out with my chair, I was trying to walk down because I dried my feet off now and I kind of have to get reacclimated to it. But while you're in the piece, you're able to kind of let go of that fear because you have been experimenting with those movements, but also because we've been adding the water slowly over time. We have done a few runs where we already have water on the stage that we add more, and we're like, okay, we've reached too much water, this is too much. But I think we kind of got to a good place with it. We had a lot of time also as well at the museum, which was amazing to be on the stage and get a lot of water runs in. And we did three runs yesterday, and that really helped us. I think that really brought the piece together.
I'm sort of curious in terms of your daily routines as far as warming up prior to rehearsals, during rehearsals, post-rehearsal, etc. Not only physically, but also mentally or emotionally, in terms of how you maybe spiritually get into a particular dance. So I know this it's a lot to answer.
This is a Lauren question. Lauren is always the first one to the studio every morning. She beats me there.
That's very true. I think everyone has their own routines physically. I need a lot of prep time for my body. I like to throw in some Pilates exercises before I start, some stretching, and then we all come together in the morning. We have a ballet class. It's usually about an hour 15. For the water piece, we were on our hands a lot, so we actually had Joe kind of lead a more contemporary warm-up following our ballet class, to get our shoulders and our wrists ready for that piece, which was something a little different. And then as far as the rest of the mental and spiritual, I think we all have different things for that too. I know pre-performance, I like to kind of find a quiet space, put headphones on, go over some of the movements, maybe some of the trickier parts that have counts that we really need to be tight on, and then just kind of get into a zone, maybe set an intention for the piece. I know David and I were backstage before the water piece and we were kind of setting an intention to get us all on the same page and stay really grounded and safe in the water and just feel good about that before we come on. So there's a lot of different elements to our pre-show prep. I think we started at about 4:00 today to get ready for this one. Yeah.
You dance with so much emotion. I have a lot of people that I know that are really good dancers, but they don't have enough emotion in their dance. So how do you find how to do that?
Hi, I'm Laura. One thing that I really resonate with is, yes, I'm a dancer, but I'm also a human. Everyone in this audience has experienced happiness, they have experienced sadness, everyone has experienced falling in love. So, because dance is my art form, I want to also incorporate my whole life into my movement. So yes, there's technique and things that you need to worry about, but it's something deeper inside that I also want to relate with the audience, because yeah, dance. But yeah, exactly, like I know sitting in an audience, I've also watched many dance shows, and something that really sticks out for me is like, yeah, you can do a leg, you can do a turn, of course, but if you don't speak to me, and if I can't relate with you, then it's like,
Richard. Hi, I'm Richard. I think something that's really beautiful to experience as an audience member is us being genuine. And I think sometimes we get nervous and it's hard for us to feel honest with ourselves and honest with our partners. But in this particular piece, I just do not take my eyes off of her eyes. And I think it, we just start to speak and we start to communicate, and I think the audience wants us to be genuine with each other, and I think when you see that, there's also a relationship that happens between the audience and us, where, it's a huge exchange, and I think the more genuine you are with your performance and the more genuine you are with your partner, I think the more it just like pours out of you like water.
As a choreographer, how do you come up with these variations of what to do? I've never seen anybody dancing on the side of a wall. The water. It's just amazing what you do with it, and also of course the music, and it was, the whole thing was so interesting and innovative, and plus amazing dancers. How do you come up with everything?
I don't sleep. it comes in waves, like anything, and every piece sort of has its time and its place, and sometimes I sit with ideas in a notebook somewhere and it's not right when the idea comes, or you know, sometimes we don't have funding to make an idea happen in the way that I want it to happen. Like the Trees Ballet has been put on pause because it's gonna be huge. Helena and I wanna have like a whole symphony, and that obviously comes with a huge cost, and I'm not willing to sacrifice my artistic integrity just to push something out. For me, this piece was so site-specific, right? When Masha came to me and Sarah Linda, you know, last year about being the teaching artist in residence here, and that it was gonna be inspired by the Rivers Flow Artist Connect exhibit, I was like, I don't know where I'm going with this. and I sat with it for a while, and actually a mutual friend of Sydney's and mine reached out to me, and she knew that I was kind of, you know, sitting with some ideas, but nothing was really like, this is what it is. And she sent me Sydney's film, and I was blown away. And I'd like to have you talk about your film a little bit in a second. But then it kind of became, I want to make a work that's not just about a river, because that's not what I do either. It's, you know, something about social responsibility or civic engagement, environmental stewardship. There's got to be a greater message to the work. I think we're living in a time as artists, it's our responsibility to educate and to inspire and to unite communities. So this idea of you know, where are these artists coming from with their stories, and how can I bring their stories to life through dance? Because I'm working within the medium of ballet, which has been historically homogenous. Women haven't been given a voice as choreographers. Last year, I think fewer than 25% of ballets choreographed by major US ballet companies were being choreographed by women. So to me, it was like, let me find six incredible artists, and let me make this ballet that's inspired by these women and their stories. And Sydney was one of those people. Really, the first two sections, the dry sections actually, were inspired by Sydney. But so it was this process of percolating, and you know, then as I'm diving into what's Sydney's story and how is she inspired and how is her artistic practice inspired by water and rivers. It makes these crazy ideas in my head, and I remember having coffee with you and saying, you know, visually, what is a piece of your film that is super meaningful to you? And she had several moments in the film, and I was like, how do I make those moments with, you know, that are pedestrian in essence and not dance, how do I make them into movement? And then Sherazade, who's another artist, Garcia, who I spoke with in depth about her artistic practice, you know, she's so optimistic about everything. And to speak with her and her influence about water, she inspired the final movement of the program. There were influences and inspirations from these people, but then it's also like silly things end up happening, like the holding of the ball in the water, those are actually water balloons. I was getting ready to do our first day of rehearsal with water in the studio, and I needed a big bucket to bring water from the bathroom into the studio, and my daughter's water balloons were sitting in our utility sink. And I was like, wow, this is serendipitous. This could really be cool. Like, how can we incorporate, you know, these water balloons into the ballet? And of course, hers are like hot pink, so I'm like, where do I find clear ones of these? Amazon. So, you know, things happen in strange ways, and because we have this non-traditional stage shape, it was like, well, how can we use the wall and propel dancers against the wall, or like Claire jumping off of the wall? So things happen in weird and interesting ways, but I'd love Sydney to talk a little bit about her film, because it really inspired, you know, these first two movements of the work.
That just seems so easy and preventable, and then you look out throughout Black history and why a lot of Black people don't know how to swim, the stereotype created about it, and I just wanted to create a piece that touched on that, because it's not only swimming water in the Black community, because the piece is essentially about the relationship between Black community and water, but not only is it swimming that is an issue, and enslaved people being banned from learning the fear that they steal themselves away and swim away. Oh, I'm sorry. Not my thing. But also, when you think about dirty water in Black communities, and like in Flint, and but also good things. So when you think about pouring libations and spirituality and baptism. So I just wanted to talk about like all things water and Blackness. And yeah, just kind of start a conversation about that. And I'm really happy that you saw the piece and was inspired by it. Yeah. Oh, yeah, it's not public right now. I think I can make it public now that it's through with the film festivals. So I actually will put it on YouTube now, like you said.
And we'll share it on our social media.
I have a question. How did you integrate the music with the dance pieces? It was fabulous, and everything seemed to flow together. So what was your inspiration for the various songs that you chose to go along with the various dance moves?
Yeah, so the first two pieces of music I selected were actually the first two pieces of the ballet, and they're actually pieces of music that were covered by Moby on his play album, and so is the final piece in the program, or not covered, sampled, sorry. I'm always fascinated by artists sampling other people's music. It kind of seems like taking it for their own self, But it was, they're folk artists. I love folk music. And so for those pieces, it was again, celebrating other artists, celebrating their voices. The third piece in the program is a piece by Rory Anderson. She has an album that she released that's really inspired by a lot of environmental activism. And that particular piece of music is called The Water Will Rise. I think we're all realizing the water is rising everywhere. So that kind of came from that. The fourth piece in the program is actually whale and deep sea noises. And then, where am I? Whales. Then the hang drums. I love hang drums. And there was something that felt really rhythmic in the right kind of way of water flowing. So that's kind of where that piece came from. And then we came full circle back to the folk music. Again, a piece that was sampled by Moby in his play album, by Bill Lanford at the very end. So the music came from sort of all different places. I don't traditionally do that for a work. Usually I stick with the composer, you know, Polina with Working on Trees, and it'll be her beautiful string symphony for a whole, you know, 50 minutes or hour. So it kind of, again, this piece was built in a lot of different interesting ways because I found inspiration from, you know, these six different women to really bring this work together. So yeah, there were a lot of changes. I think the dancers can talk to that. And initially I wanted a silent section, and then I came in one day and I was like, scrap that idea, that's awful. And then the hang drum happened. Yeah, I think we have time for like one more question. Evan's all the way up there. You want to go to Evan? I think that's Evan.
Oh, Evan.
Katara and I were sitting back here. We were wondering from the dancers, have you ever danced with water before? Is this a routine that you've done before?
And now that you've had this beautiful experience with water, will you do it again?
I've done photo shoots in water, but I haven't quite danced in water, which was, you know, slippery in moments. I would do it again. I think there's just, I wish there was a way we could, like, keep the water leveled.
Right?
Just, like, stay right and get more splashes, but I would do it again.
So I haven't done a piece with water, but I have a twin sister who's also a dancer, and she did do a piece with water on the stage. And she had some really helpful advice. Actually, I think that we implemented that in the piece. And she said that if the stage is wet, like the same level of slippery or like wet all the way around, it's less slippery than if you randomly come across a slippery spot. And then that's when your feet are like, oh, I can't handle it. So we ended up, you saw the first few splashes were pretty strategic about where you were getting it on the stage, that we get the canvas the same amount saturated exactly. And then, you know, it's kind of up to the dancers at that point, but it kind of does neutralize it a little bit, and that was really